welcome to Disability Viewpoints, now in our 25th year. My co-host today is Joan Willshire. You'll see Darrell Paulsen up here on the set. Joan, who's your guest today?
I have three great guests. Darrell Paulsen from Paulsen and Company, Maren Schroeder, who's one of the action leaders in the cannabis issue, as well as Leili, Fatehi, lobbyist for the particular issue as well. And so it's a jam-packed time that we're going to be together talking about the passage of the cannabis legislation in Minnesota.
It's a busy half hour, and they created a new state agency for the marijuana.
It's fabulous.
Great, great. Well, my guest today is Trevor Turner from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities, and we're going to do a pretty thorough legislative update. And so he'll be along in a minute on this very station. Thank you. Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. I have a special day around here. We have Darrell Paulsen on the set from Paulsen and Companies. He's going to be on the next interview, but we're going to do a legislative update with Trevor Turner from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities. And it's been the busiest year I know down at the House and Senate. So, Trevor, welcome to the show.
You know, this session, as you said, was a really, really busy session. And in fact, there, I think the name I'm hearing is now the Minnesota Miracle 2.0, with the last Minnesota Miracle was in 1973, 50 years ago, which had saw significant investments in education and things like that, which had a transformative impact on our workforce and kind of led Minnesota to go from an agrarian state to the modern Minnesota economy that we have now. And now we, this year in 2023, we had just as busy and impactful of a legislative session with significant investments in all over. But, you know, this legislative session really has roots in the 2022 legislative session. You know, we saw in 2022, we didn't actually see a lot because of the partisan gridlock that we saw because of our divided government. And we had a $12 billion surplus that was left unspent. And then that later that year, because nothing was passed, that surplus ballooned to an $18 billion surplus for the 2023 legislative session. So the DFL definitely wanted to take advantage of this unique opportunity. The last time the DFL had a trifecta was in 2014, but they were much less ambitious then because they were more concerned about holding on to power, which they lost anyway. So I think that this time they learned their lesson that, you know, it's too unpredictable the future. So it's best to take advantage of unique opportunities now. And so they absolutely did. And so we saw, you know, high priorities right away out the gate. And so we saw, you know, issues ranging from abortion rights protections to children lunch, school lunches free for everyone. We saw the voting rights restored for people who had former felonies. We saw a lot of different things. And those were both of the big cultural issues that, you know, Democrats have been campaigning on for a long time. And they wanted to take advantage of it. And so we saw a lot of that. But then they also had, this was a budget year. So they had to spend not only establish a budget for the next 2 years, but they had an additional $18 billion to spend and invest into the state government or into the state. And so that is one of the reasons why we just saw such a productive legislative session, because, you know, Democrats wanted to get things done while they had the chance.
Right. And half of that money we saw go into education per Governor Walz, because obviously he's a football coach, a social studies teacher, an educator. So half of that went to that. Now, if you look at the whole session, and it just got done, what were your biggest, you think, accomplishments? What were your biggest disappointments, if there were any? I mean, this was a pretty good session.
It was a pretty good session. You know, every year the Council on Disability comes up with a legislative priority list. And, you know, normally we're happy to see two or three things pass. But this year, on our legislative priority list, we saw over, I believe, I think 17 different issues of ours that were included. Now, a lot of these issues were things that we had been working on for
years.
So it's not like it was a brand new thing. A lot of these things were things that were just ready to go and just needed that final, initiative to get it done. Yeah. And so it's been great as far as our legislative priorities have been kind of wiped clean. And so now we have for 2024 have to come up with a new legislative priority list because, so many things were passed. And I think, some of the biggest things we saw major investments in personal care attendants, increasing pay. We saw better benefits for them and trying to increase the retention and hiring of PCAs in the workforce. We saw a lot of, even the Council on Disability, we got a major investment in our agency. We saw about a $1.4 million increase in our budget, which we plan to use for hiring more staff to provide better programming for people with disabilities in the state and better advocacy for people with disabilities at the state. And we also saw the passage of the hiring and retention of employees with disabilities for the state.
Right.
This was increasing the goal to increase the employment and retention of people with disabilities in the state, which I believe will have a transformative impact on our state because it will bring more people with disability to the governing table. And I think that when you have more people with disabilities at the governing table making disability policies, and it will improve our disability services and policies in the state.
That opened a real door. And by the way, an acronym for PCA, the total definition for people watching, mm-hmm. is personal care attendant. We want to be clear about that. There you go.
Yes.
So, yeah.
And I have another acronym for PCA. We'll talk about that in the next section.
All right, very good. And
but the one thing I would like to say, Mark, as well, is we've seen the governor and we've seen the legislature make significant investments in transportation as well. And in the fact that there's going to be three quarters of a cent sales tax in the metro area on our gas. That's the first time that's been done. We've raised the gas tax in about 20 years, and that will allow us to make significant improvements in transit in the metro area. It will also allow us to implement a safety and security plan that is much needed in several of our communities where Metro Transit operates. I mean, we're making significant investments in family and children. I mean, Trevor, the list goes on and on. So I'm glad to be partnering with you on many issues that the council cares about and that we care about in the disability community.
What do you think your significant role was this session?
I think the significant win just overall was just getting the attention of the government and focusing on disability issues. And we really saw that this legislative session, that there was a high priority to improve and invest in the disability community in our state. And so I think just overall, just having that acknowledgement, hopefully we can keep carrying that on to the next legislative session. The next legislative session, it's the same government. We don't have any elections for the House or the Senate or the governor next year. And so it will be the same government next year. So hopefully we can continue that momentum and continue to improve and improve on policies and investment for the state.
Is there anything else you want to add before we go?
Yeah, so there's actually one thing that kind of happened towards the very, very end of session that I have been watching throughout the legislative session, but it didn't really seem to have too much of a disability angle until the very, very end of session, and that was the Uber and Lyft bill by Senator Fatehi and Representative Hassan, who were trying to improve the pay and benefits for Uber and Lyft drivers in the state. And that was the bill that it passed the House and the Senate, but the governor issued his one and only veto. Since 5 years as governor, he vetoed this bill because one of the main reasons he vetoed the bill was because of they were afraid that that disability services were going to be impacted by the bill for Uber and Lyft. And so he used disability services as one of the reasons why he vetoed that bill. And so it was, I would say, a little disappointing because, you know, Council on Disability, we weren't really consulted on it. It wasn't, I got a call from Senator Fatehi like almost an hour before the governor vetoed the bill saying, you know, why is the disability community against this bill? And in large part had to do with the fact that in Dakota County, they partner with Lyft to provide service, provide rides for people with disabilities, but not those with who are wheelchair users. You know, that's one of the issues with Uber and Lyft. They do not have wheelchair accessible vehicles.
No.
It's something that we have been trying to, as you know, Mark, one of our priorities was expanding access to and improving the service for Metro mobility. And one of the things we tried for years, tried to get the TNCs or transportation network companies like Uber and Lyft to provide accessible vehicles. But Dakota County, it was partnering with Lyft to provide not accessible rides, but for rides for some people with disabilities. And the governor used that as one of the reasons why he vetoed the bill.
Yeah.
And so I'm hoping that next session we can use that as a talking point to really, you know, improve, talk to Uber and Lyft and say, you know, you got what you wanted. You got the bill vetoed, but you cited disabilities as one of the reasons. So hopefully you'd be willing to maybe invest in some accessible vehicle fleets if you're that concerned about people with disabilities.
The caveat to that, Trevor, is you'll see that even though the governor did issue his one and only veto that he's ever issued in 5 years that he's been in office, is that he also required them to create a study that would allow them to look at the study, the conditions relating to safety, and what I would call other benefits that Uber and Lyft drivers don't get because they use their own cars and those kind of things.
Absolutely.
Once that study goes through, and that study is required to be issued to the legislature by January, so it will be out before we even get into next session, which starts February 12th. Already, if you can believe it, I'm already planning some things.
I'm sure you
already
are.
For February already. So what I want to say is that even though the veto happened, what has caused that to happen is the study, and the study is really what's going to drive the momentum for next year.
I'm going to run this over, but I have a couple things to add quickly. I talked to one of the drivers at Transit Team, and he said that Lyft was trying to contact them to contract to do the Lyft wheelchair accessibility. Now, isn't public, it isn't negotiated yet, but that's the offing. The other thing I want to talk about MetroBility, and I was really livid about this, is that on May 31st, I had to cancel my curbside because I had no groceries to bring home, and going to work, and the operator, the reservations told me, well, it's company policy, they can't change the ride till I get in the bus at 9:30. I said, that has nothing to do with it. So I called customer service, and they said there's no policy like that. So here I had a reservationist making up the rules as we're going along, and I won't tolerate that. Anyway, thanks for being with us, Trevor. I wanted to put that out to you to see if the state council wants to mull that over and call me, and I'll tell you. And when we can act on it, I've shot an email to Justin Page and Kelly Moeller and Frank Hornstein to let them know that I wasn't happy. So we'll talk soon. Thanks for being on Disability Viewpoints. And Joan Willshire and Darrell will be right back with the next segment on the passage of marijuana at the state. We'll be right back with more Disability Viewpoints.
Well, Minnesota has finally done it. They've legalized marijuana in the state of Minnesota. So what does this mean for people with disabilities in the state of Minnesota? Well, I've got three individuals here today as guests, and we're going to have a conversation about the bill that was just recently signed by Governor Walz. And we're going to talk about what impacts this might have on the disability community. So with me today, we've got Darrell Paulsen. He is a transit and disability specialist with Paulsen & Company. Maren Schroeder, Policy Director for Sensible Change Minnesota, and then Leili Fatehi, She is partner and principal of Apparatus GVC and Blunt Strategies. So welcome, all three of you. Do we need to do a, like, clapping and yay and yelling and screaming? You finally got it passed?
No, we can add those sound effects in as we go through.
I mean, this is a long time coming for all of you, right?
It is, it is. And thank you to the great ladies on the screen. Thank you for the work that you've done over the last several years. And what this means to patients, and what this means to people in Minnesota, is it means that we all have a quality product, safe and reliable, consistent product that we're currently using already.
So, well, let's talk about the legislation, jump into that, and like what actually is going to happen, how soon will people have access to it, how much can people grow and sell. Leili, do you want to jump in with some of those facts?
Sure. So this bill legalizes the adult use, meaning also recreational cannabis in Minnesota. You know, the first question a lot of people have is, when are these products going to be available on the market? When will dispensaries open? Well, first, the first thing that has to happen is the government has to create an Office of Cannabis Management. It needs to do rulemaking to set up the process by which it will accept applications and issue licenses to those businesses. The current timeline that we've seen is looking like those dispensaries will be opening up in late 2024, early 2025. But the home grow provisions of the bill, and Minnesota is one of only 11 states that allows home grow, those take effect August 1, and that allows people to grow up to 8 plants, up to 4 of which can be mature and flowering at any given time in their homes. So we do want to ensure people have the caveat that there will still be possession limits, and those are a possession limit of 2 pounds that you can have at home. So people should be cognizant of that when they're doing their own home grow. But August 1 is also the date that the new possession limits take effect, and the automatic expungement of records begin for those who have criminal convictions, lower level for cannabis possession crimes. We're pretty excited.
Wow, that's fantastic. But it sounds like there's a wait time, though, where people are going to be able to have access to it. So my wondering, what are people, are we going to have to be purchasing it the same way everyone's been doing it?
What I can say, Joan, is that it's going to be no different than it is now. And for the medical side, the medical program will stay intact, at least for the foreseeable future. We don't know what those changes will look like at some point. The new changes that we're excited about is it eliminates the registration fee, and it also will, in 2025, it will go into effect where it will allow your doctor to certify you for a 3-year period instead of every year that it's currently been doing that.
Sure.
So, and for me, the expungement piece is really important as well, because it took me over 10 years to get an expungement for a quarter pound of pot that I pled guilty for and basically designed my own punishment in the late 90s. So, I'm really excited that those folks won't have to go through the 10 years that I had to go through.
Sounds like people are excited about the expungement piece and so forth, but what were some of the challenges, though, to get this through?
Maren can speak to some of those things, I believe, as well. I mean, some of the things that we heard were they were worried about it would impact the low-level gummies and the low-level THC edible products. And frankly, I mean, we haven't heard enough about this, but I will say this on camera publicly. The fastest growing population that is consuming cannabis today is senior citizens. So when I talk to seniors, they tell me every day, don't let the state get rid of our gummies. We want our gummies. And I'm saying, can you clarify what gummies you're talking about? And they'll say, the THC marijuana gummies. So we need to make sure we clearly send that message to care providers and other facility makers that the seniors don't want those products to go away.
Yeah, so having a DFL trifecta certainly helped the situation. As many are aware, we passed a similar bill in the House in 2021 that was passed over to the Senate and left to die. I think with a bill this size, the size alone was a challenge, and just the work that it took to try to make it right. And then because this bill encompassed so many jurisdictions and so many areas, there were a lot of stakeholders. And trying to manage stakeholders was one of my roles through this, at least allied stakeholders, those that were supportive of the bill.
How does our legislation now that's passed in law, how does it compare to other states?
I think we created a really unique licensing structure and focus as to smaller businesses. And especially we created a mid-tier license that is not big cannabis, but it's also not a tiny operation. And that's called the Mezzo license. I'm really excited about that. And then Minnesota takes a lot of heat for how bad our medical cannabis program is and has been over the years with the limited providers and affordability and accessibility. But one thing that has held true since the bill was passed, and I know Darrell worked on this, is we have really strong civil patient protections, anti-discrimination provisions. And we were able in this bill to include an attorney's fees provision as well as statutory damages for patients that have had that have been discriminated against by landlords, employers, healthcare providers, et cetera. So I think really shoring that up makes us definitely mm-hmm. a unique place in the country for patient protection.
Sure. You know, I guess when you're looking at recreational marijuana versus the medicinal, are they equal in terms of?
Absolutely not. The medical side, I will say that there's 40,000 people, and roughly about 40,000 people enrolled in our medical program. I think the recreational adult use cannabis will only increase that once we start to roll out some education and some understandings of the difference between adult use cannabis and medical cannabis. I think you'll start to see both of those numbers greatly increase. Once the Office of Medical Cannabis is open in July, you'll start to see an influx of educational stuff come out, mm-hmm. I believe, at the end of the year as well. You know.
Because the point of controversy has often been around adult use versus, you know, medical, that politically is less controversial as a concept, a lot of the testimony that was being heard in committee really centered around adult use because that was the more politically challenging and just the new law. Right. There was considerable work being done on the medical provisions, both by MN is Ready, which is the coalition that Maren and I were directing, especially Maren. Was really a leader in advancing some of the good provisions that were adopted there. And then, of course, the medical cannabis companies, those two companies, they have their own lobbying teams as well that have pre-established relationships with legislators, and they certainly were a part sure. of the conversation too.
Well, one thing we haven't talked about real quickly here is the stigma. Is there stigma? It seems like, you know, it should be less now that the bill has been passed and it's legal.
But I think, you know, Joan, I think the stigma still exists, you know, in certainly communities that are more conservative than others. But I think it really boils down to educational, and it boils down to a community sense of attitudinal change. We've got to get out there. We've got to show people in the public that cannabis users are not scary, they're not lawbreakers, they're actually productive citizens of society. And
once we change those attitudinal barriers that we have in the community, mm-hmm. I think you'll see cannabis flourish in Minnesota, and the people that are behind it will flourish as well.
I actually think one of the coolest pieces of Minnesota's law is our hemp law, with the edibles and beverages being available everywhere. I think that that's actually going to increase going to make it faster, to decrease that stigma. You know, you can walk into a liquor store and buy THC seltzer next to alcoholic seltzer. Yeah. And so that in and of itself is normalization of consumption.
Fantastic. I will say we've got the phone number up for the new State Department that was created for the Department of Cannabis. We'll have that running up on the screen here so people can contact them if they have further questions. But thanks for all three of you for coming on board, and congratulations on finally getting this through for all the state of Minnesota.
Well, thank you, Joan, and thank you to the ladies joining us on the screen. Much work. I love you both. I'll find something for you guys to do next year, so hang in there. We'll be talking. So, thanks.
We'll be right back after these messages.
A lawyer, a teacher, a warehouse worker, a fitness instructor, a software engineer. What do all these people have in common? Well, they are all Minnesotans who are blind, deafblind, or visually impaired, heading to their jobs every day.
State Services for the Blind, or SSB, helps blind, deafblind, and visually impaired Minnesotans create a path to reach their career and employment goals. That might mean learning the skills of living well with vision loss, getting training in technology, developing a resume, finding an open position, or working with an employer to figure out some job accommodations.
At SSB, customers set their career goals, and we provide training and resources to help Minnesotans achieve those goals.
An accountant, a baker, an office manager, a small business owner, a customer service rep, an architect, blind, deafblind, and visually impaired Minnesotans are hard at work in all these careers, and lots more too.
If you have vision loss and are looking for work or looking to advance in your career, just give us a call at 651-539-2300 or visit mnssb.org. State Services for the Blind, independence, equality, opportunity, achievement.
Well, as always, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints. We hope you'll watch again next time. We had a busy half hour, a lot of stuff at the legislature going on at the House and Senate as we closed the session for this year. But on February 12th of 2024, we'll do it all over again. Joan, and how did your segment have today?
It was absolutely fabulous. We learned so much about the new cannabis legislation, and it's going to be exciting couple of years as this moves forward with people being able to access both recreational and medical marijuana.
It's a really big move for Minnesota. Darrell, do you want to say a couple words while we wrap this up?
It's a big move for Minnesota, tremendously in the cannabis world, but more importantly, it's big for Minnesota families. You know, this year at the legislature, the governor and the legislatures, the senators included, have made significant investments for families in Minnesota.
Again, as always, thanks for watching. Thanks to the team at SPNN, and we'll see you soon. Bye for now.